Just imagine if your family doctor told you that your children have been selected for a mental stunting program. They are to be prescribed a medication that limits their growth to such a degree that the complex world of adult mental development was going to be dramatically reduced for them, and they would never reach their fullest mental capacities at any stage for the rest of their life. The program only lasts for the first 5 years of their life, and it's compulsory. You can see the drug advert now. Don't want your kids to outshine you. Try Starve Them All, a new infant formula that will destroy generations of kids without the messy business of mass graves. Such a prescription is unfortunately all too real for many people. Albeit this is a fictional rendition in this dramatic sense, I'm simply portraying the very real and stark reality many families in countries like Uganda are facing due to some basic flaws in our world order. Malnutrition threatens to destroy a generation of children in Uganda. More than one-third of all young children, 2.4 million, are stunted. The damage caused by stunting is irreversible. Between 2013 and 2015, it's estimated that more than 500,000 young Ugandan children died. Of these deaths, nearly half were associated with undernutrition. Undernutrition is responsible for 40% of the deaths of children under the age of five. The combined effects of malnutrition on healthcare costs and education, based on 2009 data, it's the equivalent of a staggering 5.6% of the nation's GDP. That's $899 million. I can think of no greater crime than to let starve millions of infants and youth, and yet it is happening all around us in many countries all over the world today. After thousands of hours of immersive experience in the grassroots development work in Uganda, I've come to understand that we can only truly tackle the big problems humanity faces by understanding the all too often overlooked elements of our life on Earth, which bind us to the soils of it. So many of our issues do ultimately relate to our soils after all. And there are plenty of solutions to these critical problems. So why are they still persisting? And when are we going to overcome these terrible problems? I was given the chance in 2014 to put my ideas of transforming childcare facilities to improve the living conditions through the use of home food production models and various other techniques related to water, cooking, and land management. Most orphanages are dependent on donors for just about everything to care for their kids, and very few have robust home gardens where the children can learn a practical life skill and increase their nutrient uptake at the same time. With just $15,000, we transformed this one facility, and the results were spectacular. 6 months after completion, we were told by the orphanage that they were saving $1,000 per month on average. With less sickness and medical costs, next to nothing for food bills, huge water savings, the facility was finally able to keep up with their staff salaries. But beyond this, I witnessed several children who had emotional trauma. They had positive turnarounds and responses to the gardens. My return visit to see the once barren children's center a full year later was like walking through the Garden of Eden. And the kids couldn't wait to show me how they were continuing to cultivate their very own food forests and permaculture raised bed gardens. This led me to continue to train over 28 such children's homes and develop several curriculums pertinent to the development of robust community gardens in the East African context, and ultimately became the inspiration for my life's work, which is now spawning new enterprises with vast potential to reshape our world's supply chains in the African context. Through participating and managing dozens of such projects using sustainable design science, I have witnessed the success that comes from getting out and actually doing the work. So yes, we need more doers getting outside and taking action, but we need to understand the solutions are in the relationship we have with nature, and not a faith-based or emotionally biased set of ideologies, which have no bearing on the tangible results that end the cycles of poverty. Well-wishers and volunteers are no new thing to Africa. Unless practical skills are transferred wholly to the communities you're working with, the works to end these big problems will not be sustained, for it is a cultural undertaking, and it takes more than a few donations of goods and services to shift the underlying behaviors that may ruin children's futures. Now, more than ever, we need to exemplify the saying, trade, not aid, and activate an ethical business of activate ethical businesses for rural populations to bring themselves out of poverty. Students need tangible and natural solutions they can actually grasp with their own hands. Religious and ideological theories and beliefs can sometimes support people to do the hard work that needs to be done, but all too often they become the focus rather than the support mechanism, and the real solutions are lost in the confusion of the supernatural ideas rather than remaining grounded on the natural processes that actually work to restore dignity and health to humankind. In my own small example, I can tell you that I believe in angels, but I do not rely on ethereal beliefs to actually do any of the work that needs to be done to reverse the pain too many people are waking up to every day just because of where they are born. I'm not a nutritionist, but I'm tackling malnutrition. I'm not a botanist, but I'm reforesting ecologies and manufacturing some of the world's best superfoods and plant medicine through dozens of herbal plants. I'm a permaculture designer. Permaculture design science, which I practice to undertake all of my business models, is about being able to work with all disciplines and all sciences to bring them together and bridge the divides between them to create truly multidisciplinary cultures that bring about positive changes to people's daily lives. The breadth of sciences, data, skills, and trades which permaculture design enables covers such an exhaustive list, you could spend many, many years to try to figure out what you want to do with it. I only realized, after 10 years of working with it, that I was tackling malnutrition when I was reforesting all these damaged landscapes. So I feel it's helpful for students when teachers find ways to simplify the whole spectrum of these initiatives into profound and simple truths that show how simple solutions can be. And one of my favorite reductions that inspires me is simply the word shade. Most, if not all, sustainable work ultimately boils down to how much shade we create in our societies. Want to help the planet? Get out there and make shade. Specifically plant shade in this case. We need shade, the living impression of contrast of trees and plants and all their fruits on the surface of the earth. It is the end result of a living ecology that is using sunlight to create sustainable resources for the planet and humanity. Creating more shade in our villages and countries through the use of agroforestry is just one of hundreds of solutions, but it is the result of a dynamic approach to solving poverty. I hope you will come to see how we can and will create better living conditions wherever we create more shade. Through my early experience of falling in love with Uganda since 2005, I remember the heartbreak I felt when I read the 2008 National Environmental Management Report, which stated that the country would lose all of its high canopy jungle by 2050. The forest cover was around 24% in 1995, and now it's down to around 8%. The country's current malnutrition rate is around 30%, and the poverty rate has again shot up due to COVID. But this spike in poverty pales in comparison to the long-lasting impact that loss of forests ultimately creates on smaller countries like Uganda, where more and more people will be depending on fewer resources over time. It's a real-life nightmare unfolding right before our eyes, and it spells disaster for millions of people if nothing is done about it. We simply cannot allow the forests to die. We must bring them back. But how? We need a dynamic solution. Many ideas working in unison. We need to place new value on forest ecologies and integrate them into the rural household and farming landscapes. This will not only reduce the need to forage into the remaining reserves, but also increase the number of species and provide a tapestry of forests throughout the country for animals and insect populations to regenerate, those being the basis of soil itself. We need biologically sensitive forests, not just monocultures of exotic imports, which further repel biodiversity from rebuilding in the country. With the time left, I will share with you my top four ideas related to agroforestry, which are actively focused on reducing human suffering. These ideas are bringing profound positive changes to the systemic problems causing humanity in so many ways, causing humanity to suffer in so many ways. Number four, the living fence and what we call edge forests. Any family with even a small parcel of land can plant trees and shrubs around their plot of land relevant to their climate to greatly increase their access to fuel wood, food, medicine, and increase the security and water retention of their crops. The trees provide wind reduction, shade, and in many cases directly impact the soil fertility of the land around them. They also produce timber for construction and firewood for the kitchen, as well as being a source of fodder for animals and mulch for the gardens and breeding grounds for local birds, some of which fly down from Europe. By planting more trees, we're helping to repopulate all different types of species. If you plant just 365 trees around your plot of land, then within 1 to 2 years, you technically have a sustainable daily source of firewood. But these living fences are dynamic. We plant tall, medium, and small species together. They share space, they share light, and they share soil nutrient to produce miniature forests around our land and home that also have fruits, medicine, and provide security by keeping ruminants from entering our crop and eating it. A well-made living fence is an example of a design principle to value the marginal, to create what's known as an edge, which captures and produces fertility in so many ways, passively giving us what we need in our life. Imagine if every rural family in Africa planted food, fuel, and medicinal trees around their compound to supply themselves with firewood for cooking, supplements in their diets, and stave off lists of diseases. This would be a huge step in the right direction for the continent. Operation Wealth Creation, keep on going. Number three, Moringa and the herbal foods industry. This is an approach to forestry that recognizes the immense wealth of nature and nature's creations, and how much they produce more than just a shade to sit under. This is a side of forestry in which we not only see trees for timber, but also for their medicinal, phytochemical, and nutrient byproducts. Uganda has one of the continent's largest biological species pool due to its many various climates and bioregional zones, and all of these are under threat of extinction if we don't place new value on them, as they are being stripped away from our very eyes by commercial activities and survival needs. We are witnessing the loss of the continent's best nursery for regreening its vast territories. Can we not use commercial enterprise to reverse these negative trends? I personally say we absolutely must. There are thousands of plants out there with immense immune strengthening and bodybuilding powers just waiting for us to exploit them in the right way. Through agroforestry, we have the opportunity to place value on any part of a tree if it has proven phytochemical nutrients which are useful and aid humanity in its struggle for a healthy living lifestyle. One great example of a catalyst cash crop to vivify the forest medicine industry is Moringa. This tree is the ultimate green supplement. It tastes like grass, but it packs a nutrient density and profile of proteins and other phytocompounds that massively support the human body's regular functions, with as little as 2 grams a day added to any food or drink. Moringa can greatly reduce the impact of malnourishment for millions of people. It's a growing billion-dollar industry projected to reach $9 billion by 2025, and the farmers themselves are the first to benefit from its production models. It can make over 19 times the income on a per-acre basis compared to subsistence crops, and it's one of the hardiest species known to science, which intercrops with most other food and herbal plants. The phytochemical industry is a growing billion, if not trillion-dollar industry with vast opportunities available at all stages of its supply chain. Is it not possible that we may find millions of jobs in such an industry for so many job seekers? To me, these plants and these medicines are the new gold in Africa. Second to last idea, the culturally relevant management system, Priceless Farms. The company we have created has shown us that we can, with minimal to no interference in people's beliefs, faiths, or current cultures, regrow forested landscapes and provide dozens of jobs over small areas of land in rapid speed, with no end in sight for the expansion of the model. Priceless Farms is the corporate framework we have been developing over the last 6 years that anyone can work with and utilize anywhere on the continent to produce truly resilient cultures of agroforestry production. Over time, these companies can generate excessive wealth from such farms. Moringa alone has shown us that with a little value addition, we can generate revenue many magnitudes higher than current crops per annum. Our current management system cultivates over 40 such species known within African traditional medicine. This is a type of business management system that goes right into the very edge of poverty-stricken countries and begins reviving the most destitute communities back to a culture of shade and foraging, as opposed to the burning pains of indentureship and starvation. When you see a community shift in this way, you start to witness true miracles, not just the type you read about in books. Last idea that I want to share with you, which brings all of these technologies to bear and all of these ideas to bear. New economics, the means by which we can bring these models to scale to actually reverse the negative trends. If we talk only about scale with respect to actuating these hugely beneficial solutions to humanity's issues, and we fail to remember speed, which is finance, then we will run out of time on many of the issues, as they are so time sensitive. Once a species goes extinct, we can't bring it back, and the damaged lands end up costing us far more than those which are able to support their inhabitants. To this point, we have developed a model of a financial tracking software that will enable the purchasing of trees on sustainable forest farms from anyone, anywhere in the world, starting from a single dollar. A software that works with the culturally sensitive management system to provide startup capital to get forests planted and enable them to reach success that actually makes money for everyone involved, as these trees produce commodities for markets around the world. This software doubles as a tracking system for companies' assets and resources, as well as a means to raise vast capital instantaneously from an ever-growing forum of customers whose purchases lead to a better world and grow their wealth as well. This too is entirely within our grasp, and we hope to see the online version being released later this year. And like all these examples, this is a replicable, practical idea which can be recreated hundreds of times for the benefit of the world populations and their ecologies, because it is based on sound, measurable production models and can be tailored to any specific region or territory. As the world continues to grow, a new era of natural and clean ideas are springing to life to give humanity options of survival. It's become clear to me that without a dynamic approach to rapidly speed up our efforts to transform our current culture of production and resource use, we are going to witness untold trouble in the future. And yet, with the use of these types of ideas, the prosperity that awaits us is indescribable. We need to invest in our future by rethinking the way we view the world. I hope that, like me, you can now see that the shade of a single tree holds the blueprint of a better world in its image and clearly marks the spot where the seeds of a new generation of clean, ethical resources will surely fall. Thank you for your time.